Hi, I'm Benjamin Herrmann, and I will be showing how you can perform resolvent analysis using time-resolved flow field measurements exclusively and without recourse to the governing equations. This is work presented in a recent paper titled Data-Driven Resolvent Analysis, which I wrote in collaboration with Peter Baddoo from Imperial College, Richard Semaan from TU Braunschweig, Steve Brunton from University of Washington, and Beverley McKeon from Caltech. The paper is available on archive, and you can find a link to it in the description below. So say you have a linear stable system that's being periodically forced, then the long-term response in the frequency domain is governed by this expression, where this is the resolvent operator. This operator encodes how any disturbances to the system are filtered by the linear dynamics to produce a response. In the context of non-normal systems, we know that the resolvent behaves as a very selective amplifier of disturbances. And because of this, it is critical to understand the dynamics of such systems. This was first pointed out in the work of Trefethen and co-authors in the context of shear flows. Since then, there has been a growing interest in using this method, mainly due to its relevance to the design of flow control strategies by using the input-output framework developed by Jovanovic and Bamier, and also due to its relevance to identifying structures and scale interactions in turbulent flows by using the interpretation of nonlinearities as forcing proposed by McKeon and Sharma. And even though we know it's important and there is this great interest from the community in applying resolvent analysis to flows with two or three inhomogeneous directions, this is still not commonplace. And one of the main reasons for this is that resolvent analysis requires under-the-hood access to high-fidelity numerical solvers of the linearized governing equations. In this work, we develop a purely data-driven method that can work with black box numerical solvers and doesn't require access to adjoint solutions. So it opens up the possibility of eventually doing resolvent fully from experimental data. So now we'll be showing you how does the method work. And for that, I will be using data from direct numerical simulations of plane channel flow. And all the details of the numerical setup are in our paper. The first step is to collect a sequence of state snapshots from recording of a transient simulation starting from a perturbation to the stable system. So in this case, the state corresponds to the three velocity components in this three-dimensional flow field, which here I'm visualizing as velocity isosurfaces. Then we can enrich our data set by considering additional recordings of transients starting from different initial conditions. The second step is to assemble our data matrices, which is just stretching the state into a very long vector and horizontally concatenating these states according to their temporal sequence, followed by the temporal sequence corresponding to the next initial condition and the next initial condition and so on. And the ordering, in fact, it's not really important. What's important is that all the columns in the Y matrix correspond to the columns in the X matrix, but everything shifted one time step into the future. And the F matrix that you see there is just awaiting to adjust the inner product so that the L2 norm measures a physically meaningful quantity, which in this case is the perturbation kinetic energy. Now that we have these matrices, we use dynamic mode decomposition to approximate the leading eigenvectors and eigenvalues of the underlying linear operator that evolves our measurements. And we use this learned eigendecomposition to build our resolvent operator, but projected onto eigencoordinates. And we perform resolvent analysis, so the singular value decomposition of the resolvent on these coordinates. This projection of the resolvent was first used by Reddy and Henningsen a while back in 1993, where they used it to reduce the computational cost of computing resolvent gains. But in their case, they used the actual eigendecomposition of the system from a known operator, whereas here we're using learned eigenvectors and eigenvalues that we learned from data using DMD. So the last step is to synthesize our resolvent modes back into physical coordinates. So if we had enough data, we will get a good approximation of the actual resolvent modes of the system. And here I'm showing the optimal forcing, where I'm showing wall normal velocity isosurfaces, and the optimal response for channel flow, where I'm showing streamwise velocity isosurfaces. So these are the familiar streamwise vortices causing streamwise streaks. And here are some more results. So these are the operator-based resolvent modes, just for ground truth comparison. And these are the ones obtained from data using a data set that was generated starting from these initial conditions, where this middle plot shows the learned DMD spectrum overlaid on top of the true spectrum. And these are the data-driven resolvent modes. For this data set, we needed to retain 200 DMD modes to get this approximation. Now, what happens if we use the optimal forcing as an initial condition to generate our data set? Well, in that case, we only need 20 DMD modes to generate an even better approximation of the true resolvent modes. And what's more interesting is that we are actually learning a very specific region of the spectrum, which is something that we noticed. So the last result that I want to show you is what happens when you use a localized disturbance as the initial condition to generate the data set. Here we're using this donut-shaped perturbation, which is something that resembles what you would get in an experiment with a wall normal jet. So in this case, we get these modes, which are quite different from the true resolvent modes. So the question that arises is, are these results useful? How do they relate to the operator, the actual operator of the system, and how can we interpret these modes? It turns out that if we do an operator-based resolvent analysis, but where we restrict the input and output spaces to be in the span of the data snapshots, then we get the same modes. So this is very encouraging because it means that these results are still very valuable. We just need to be aware that what we're getting are these forcing and response modes that are constrained to live in the span of our data, which completely makes sense. Okay, so these are some points that I want to leave you with. First, this data-driven resolvent analysis inherits its capabilities and limitations from DMD. So computational cost, noise robustness, data efficiency all depend on what DMD variant you're using. Also, we want to point out that we found that it's very important that we develop more effective ways to explore the state space of dynamical systems. Also want to point out that this is the first step towards a fully experimental resolvent analysis. And we believe that this work contributes to lowering the barrier of entry to resolvent research and applications. And finally, a final remark is that we recognize that there is still a critical step missing before we can make the leap to data-driven resolvent of turbulent flows, which is we need to disambiguate the linear from the nonlinear dynamics. And that's actually something that we're working on at the moment. Okay, so thanks for watching. Again, there are a lot more details in the paper, and you can find a link to it in the description below. Thank you.